The US still doesn't have high-speed rail. A country that enjoyed some of the world's best railways a century ago has not a single bullet train, and the only one under construction hasn't exactly gone well. But there's a new company trying to bring high-speed rail to the US in just a few years' time, and it might actually work. And if that wasn't surprising enough, the whole project got its start in. This is the exciting story of America's struggle to get high-speed rail up and running, and why this latest proposal might just be its best chance yet. If you were to plan a trip between two major cities in the US, most Americans would tell you there are only two real options. Traveling by rail in the United States has not been an easy sell. People often choose to drive for hours, or opt for air travel when the distance is too great. There's a lack of trust in the reliability of trains, which is understandable given the current state of railways in the country. However, it's important to remember that this wasn't always the case. The first railroads in the US were built almost 200 years ago, and for over a century, America boasted one of the most advanced and extensively used railway networks in the world. But as we entered the middle of the 1900s, everything changed with the advent of the jet age. This new era of travel allowed people to traverse long distances across the country much more quickly. As a result, railways in the US started to lose their prominence. It's crucial to acknowledge this historical context when discussing the challenges of promoting rail travel today. By understanding the rich heritage and potential of America's railways, we can work towards building an efficient and modern high-speed railway system. But as we entered the middle of the 1900s, everything changed with the advent of the jet age. This new era of travel allowed people to traverse long distances across the country much more quickly. As a result, railways in the US started to lose their prominence. It's crucial to acknowledge this historical context when discussing the challenges of promoting rail travel today. By understanding the rich heritage and potential of America's railways, we can work towards building an efficient and modern high-speed railway system that can once again connect the nation in a convenient and sustainable manner. In the mid-20th century, while Americans were embracing the convenience of cars, the interstate highway system emerged. By the 1960s, car travel had skyrocketed, and air travel had also taken off, with a significant increase in both modes of transportation. As a result, many railway engineers shifted their focus or retired, and their replacements were often aerospace specialists. This transition led to a decline in the talent pool dedicated to railways. However, despite this decline, the United States still harbored grand ambitions for rail travel. In 1965, influenced by Japan's successful launch of the Shinkansen system, President Johnson proposed a swift response. He sought funding to investigate high-speed rail transportation between urban centers. The initial phase would involve test projects connecting Washington and Boston. This historical context highlights the significant shifts in transportation preferences and the subsequent impact on railway engineering expertise in the United States. The country's response to Japan's high-speed rail success showcases its ongoing interest in exploring innovative transportation solutions. For over a decade, high-speed tests were carried out along the so-called Northeast Corridor, achieving mind-blowing speeds of over 150 miles per hour. By 1969, services were running at lightning-fast speeds of up to 120 mph, almost on par with the ones in Japan. But my friends, in the half-century that's passed, something incredible happened. Other countries joined the high-speed railway race and catapulted ahead, leaving the US in their dust. Presenting the fastest trains in the US, the legendary Amtrak's Acela line, racing along that very same Northeast Corridor. These sleek machines can reach speeds of up to a mind-boggling 150 mile per hour. However, their top speed is limited to a short distance. Before we go any further, how fast does a train have to go before it can be considered high speed? Although there's no official definition, the International Union of Railways considers 155 miles per hour to be the minimum requirement. Sorry, Amtrak, your flagship service just misses out, but the US is trying to catch up. In December 2023, the Federal Railroad Administration announced an impressive $8 billion in new funding for passenger rail projects, which includes the highly anticipated High-Speed Rail Initiative. Among these projects is the ambitious California High-Speed Rail, currently in progress between Los Angeles and San Francisco. However, the project has encountered numerous challenges along the way. Despite 8 years of construction, less than half of the railway has been completed, and none of it has reached the two major cities. The cost of the project has also skyrocketed, surpassing the $100 billion mark. Additionally, the acquisition of land has proven to be a formidable task. In situations where property owners are aware of the project's need for their land, coupled with the significant investment and contractual agreements already in place, they may be inclined to hold out for higher compensation. This becomes particularly relevant considering the ongoing debate around eminent domain, which remains a contentious issue in the United States. According to the latest developments in high-speed railway projects in the United States, there are a few notable contenders. For instance, Texas Central is currently in the early stages of study, while Cascadia has recently obtained federal funding for the planning phase. However, both projects are not expected to be implemented in the near future. As for the California scheme, although its completion date remains uncertain, it seems to be the most advanced among the mentioned projects. Nevertheless, the future of high-speed railways in the US is still uncertain, with many variables at play. Did you know that there is a new proposal for building America's first high-speed railway? This plan has been gaining significant traction lately. What makes it so intriguing? Well, the company behind this proposal has recently accomplished something remarkable. They have completed another railway that many believed wouldn't come to fruition. Witnessing a historic moment in Florida, Brightline, the company, successfully launched its first train journey from Miami to Orlando. This railway, although not considered high speed, still offers impressive speeds of up to 125 miles per hour, making it the fastest outside the Northeast Corridor. Considering the challenges of building new railways in the US, any progress in this area is noteworthy. Brightline's achievement of building America's first high-speed railway can be attributed to several factors. One crucial factor is that it is the first privately funded rail line in the country in over 100 years, with a cost of $6 billion. Unlike traditional reliance on public funding, Brightline secured backing from Wall Street to bring these state-of-the-art trains to life. This extensive project involved the construction of over 50 bridges, including the notable St. Lucie River Bridge, which has stood for almost a century. Challenging construction techniques were also required to build some of the new underpasses, like the box jacking method, which was used to position these 3,000-ton concrete sections under two roadways with the help of hydraulic jacks. And yet, most of the work involved upgrading what was already there. Much of it runs on tracks owned by the Florida East Coast Railway, which has the same parent company as Brightline. For the completely new section between Cocoa and Orlando, Brightline made use of a state policy that allocates right-of-way next to highways for new rail lines. They decided that, when they were bought by a Wall Street firm, they wanted to do passenger rail, and they decided to use their right-of-way to do that. If you're a private operator and you're considering the potential of underused freight rail lines for passenger conversion, that's a smart move. However, let's now shift our focus to a more ambitious project on the other side of the country. Introducing Brightline West, a groundbreaking $12 billion high-speed railway connecting Las Vegas and Southern California, all the way to Los Angeles. This impressive venture is set to become America's first true high-speed rail line, boasting top speeds of at least 186 miles per hour. It's quite an audacious claim, especially considering that construction hasn't even commenced yet. The high-speed railway project, Build America's First High-Speed Railway, is set to start soon and aims to be completed by mid-2028, coinciding with the Olympics. This 218-mile, 350-kilometer line will connect a station located right on the Las Vegas Strip to Rancho Cucamonga, which is slightly over 40 miles east of LA. Commuters will have the convenience of seamlessly transferring to a Metrolink train at Rancho Cucamonga and reaching Union Station in approximately 1 hour. Previously, traveling between these cities took around 5 hours by road, but with the new high-speed railway, the journey will be reduced to roughly 3 hours. This not only saves time, but also avoids the congestion often experienced on I-15, a notorious highway prone to traffic. Moreover, the train route will largely follow the path of I-15, utilizing 96% of its alignment, allowing passengers to enjoy a straightforward journey through the high desert of San Bernardino County. By providing this information, it becomes evident that the upcoming high-speed railway will significantly enhance travel between Las Vegas and LA, offering a more efficient and enjoyable alternative to driving on congested roads. Moreover, Brightline has successfully secured a critical right-of-way alongside existing infrastructure. They have recently signed a lease agreement with the California Department of Transportation, allowing them to utilize a majority of their right-of-way in the median of a highway. This approach helps minimize some of the environmental impact associated with land acquisition. In summary, the progress made by Brightline in securing the necessary right-of-way and taking measures to reduce environmental impact showcases their commitment to implementing America's first high-speed railway. In the section discussing the financing of America's first high-speed railway, it is worth noting that the Brightline project offers valuable insights. Similar to the Florida project, Brightline West aims to minimize reliance on public funds by securing private bonds and capital. A substantial portion of the project's cost, amounting to $3.75 billion, will be covered by private sources, with the government's contribution currently confirmed to be primarily $3 billion. This innovative funding approach sets Brightline apart from the California High-Speed Rail, which has thus far relied solely on government funding. Furthermore, Brightline West has already been granted $25 million to support its design and construction, a milestone achieved in June 2023. Notably, the project enjoys bipartisan support from officials in both states involved. America's inability to build high-speed rail is a long-running saga, and many have simply accepted it will never happen. But having achieved something down in Florida that took many by surprise, Brightline is convinced it can do the same on the other side of the country, this time going a big step further. Thank you for watching this video on the incredible journey of America's first high-speed railway. We hope you enjoyed this exploration into the world of cutting-edge technology and engineering marvels. Don't forget to subscribe to Exclusive Explains, the definitive video channel that goes behind the scenes of the world's most ambitious megaprojects.